Welcome to Higher Ed Live, the live weekly web show all about the world of higher education. I am your host, Seth Odell. Thank you guys so much for joining me, and I'm really glad you can be part of today's show. Today we are talking all about net price calculators. They are now federally mandated, required on higher education websites starting October 29th. And the question is, now that they're out there, what the heck are they doing? What are they accomplishing? If anything, do they work? Do they not? Are they broken? So thank you guys for tuning in today. I have to say right off the bat, we are powering the back end of this, in part at least, from Google+. So it's going to be a little different. Bear with me if there's some tech issues and definitely let me know. As always, it is the hashtag HigherEdLive. We'll be tracking it and displaying it on the show. So before we bring on our guests and dive into the topic, I'm going to do a very quick run through of the weekly five. And even first before that, I want to say a quick thank you to our sponsors. HigherEdLive is sponsored by Integral, the creators of the Schools app on Facebook. Be sure to check out their webinar series about how they can help you leverage Facebook to increase yield and retention. That happens Wednesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern Time. I'm going to send a tweet out in just a minute if you guys are interested in checking that out. We're also sponsored by OmniUpdate, the leading web content management system CMS provider for higher education. The company's web CMS OU campus is secure, scalable, with great tools and features, deployment flexibility, and an awesome user community. In fact, it was the highest ranked CMS in a customer satisfaction survey conducted by EDU Guru in 2010. So if you need a CMS, check them out at omniupdate.com. And finally, HigherEdLive is sponsored by Scavenger, a Google-funded game about going places, doing challenges, earning points, all right on your mobile phone. Check out how DeUville College Admissions, I think I'm pronouncing it right, events have used it. I'll send a tweet out. DeUville College, check out what they've done. It's pretty neat. I'll send a tweet out in just a second. So thanks to our sponsors. Now quickly into the weekly five. Again, I'm trying to rush, guys, because, well, we have a lot of stuff to talk about today. So I want to get right into it. Weekly five, a little short. I want to let you know HigherEdLive is proud to say we have finally launched the Meet the Innovators interview series. Our first post went up all about how One School is changing the mobile game. If you haven't heard of One School, check them out. Let me put it this way. They build mobile applications for your students, and they don't come to you to do it. So whether or not you think you have a mobile presence, One School might tell you you do. They're at over 100 institutions. They can launch within 5 days for any given school. These guys are changing things and disrupting from the outside. Even if you have your own mobile app, they may come in and deliver their own. Students are digging it. Administrators, maybe not so much, but you can actually work right with them. It's an interesting conversation worth checking out. Second one, this is a story that's actually been around for a while, but I'll be honest, I missed it the first time around. It's a very upsetting story that Shorter University in Georgia bans gay employees. You cannot work for Shorter University if you are gay, and you have to sign a petition, or sorry, a letter of intent saying that you are not. The fact that this is legal is one thing, and it was disturbing in itself, but the fact that this is something that a university is doing is just outright, to me, very, very upsetting and disheartening. But I'm going to send a link out, guys. Definitely follow that story. It's an unfortunate one, I'll be talking about it more moving forward. And then lastly, I know it's weekly three, not weekly five, but you know, I'm kind of in a rush here this week. It's just a great story from Josh Kell at The Chronicle about how public colleges are struggling to respond to the Occupy protests. So it's Occupy Wall Street style protests coming to college campuses. Myself, I've been through something similar with this at UCLA, not for Occupy, but something else with tuition stuff. Being through a protest on campus is a very interesting, scary, challenging time. Worth reading the article because it can happen on anybody's campus. So that's the weekly, well, three, sorry about that. And on now to the unsolicited shout out of the week. And I'm going to keep it very short and very simple. And I just want to give a shout out to Southern New Hampshire University, my employer, because, well, I am broadcasting live from SNHU right now. And in fact, I'm going to be doing it, as you know, every Thursday at 4 p.m. Eastern time from here on out. And that's pretty great for me. Because one, it makes my wife happy because I actually have Sunday afternoons free. But also, it's just a great time for you. I know that you guys are in the office, you're thinking about this stuff, you're in the trenches, you're working hard, and this is a great opportunity to take a little bit of a break, get some professional development, have a conversation with your peers, and keep pushing that needle forward. So thank you to SNHU for letting me do it. Thank you for you guys for tuning in. So that is the weekly three and the unsolicited shout out of the week. And let's dive right into today's topic about net price calculators, because it's a lot more of a loaded topic than you think. So as I said, we have multiple guests on today, so I'm going to bring them both on, and I'll show them one at a time. So first up, next to me is Michael Fienen. So a welcome to you, Michael Fienen. He's the Director of Web Marketing at Pitt State, CTO for New Cloud, a writer at EDU Guru, a little bit of everything. You probably are following on Twitter. If not, it's at Fienen. But Fienen, how's it going?
Hi.
Glad you're here. We have a little bit of audio sync issues. No worries. Google Plus will keep it up. And then here you are seeing our next guest, which is the one and only Mark Greenfield, director for the Office of Web Services, University of Buffalo. He's a speaker, associate consultant with Noel Levitz, a very busy man. And I appreciate Mark and Michael, both of you, taking the time. So Mark, welcome back again for, I think it might be your third or fourth time now, to HigherEdLive.
Yep, happy to be here. Yeah, I'm trying to think. I think this is my fourth time on the show and always look forward to it.
I appreciate having you. I think it may make you the most regularly appeared guest. We'll have to do a little bit of calculations on our end to make sure if that's true or not. But, you know, guys, when we're talking about net price calculators, this is going to be a big loaded show, a lot of information. You know, where do we actually start? I don't care, even when you jump in a little bit, just on the chance someone's not terribly familiar with the background on net price calculators, what's kind of the very abbreviated historical version of what's going on in this realm?
Well, to start with, certainly, I hope everybody has one up now, because it's sort of time. It was October 29th that the deadline passed from the Department of Education that mandated that every Title IX institution is...
Well, it looks like we got, unfortunately, a little bit of cutting out with Michael Fienen there. Mark, do you mind jumping in? It looks like Fienen's camera has frozen. Maybe you can jump in and give us a little bit more historical background than he did.
Sure, be happy to. You know, this is something that has been in the works for quite a while. And just, you know, these calculators were required as of October 29th. And it wasn't, you know, the goal of this was to provide some transparency to college costs. You know, it's very, you know, I've always had an issue with the fact that the idea of a sticker price and a real price happens when we're looking at college costs. And this was an attempt, you know, at the federal level to bring some transparency to costs. But I think the big challenge is how well that works and if it's actually meeting that goal or not.
Absolutely. And that's why I'm so excited to talk about this today, because that's exactly what we're going to get into, is that this was federally mandated. Everybody's got to have it if you're a Title IX institution, which I'm sure almost all of you, if not all of you, are. And they're all out there now, but are they actually working at all? What's happening? What are they really trying to accomplish? And I think that's just a really, you know, interesting point. So I guess just to update you, Michael Fienen said his Chrome has crashed. He's off. We're getting him back on the call as we speak, running live, moving and shaking, making these things happen. That's what happens when you have a live show, but good thing we can always handle it. So Mark, you know, what things do these calculators have to include? I mean, what's the goal, at least as far as how they're mandated? What are they supposed to be calculating?
Sure. The idea here is that we're going to try to estimate, based on the same kind of data that the FAFSA uses, what it's going to cost to go to school. So we're going to look at things like estimated tuition and fees, estimated room and board, books and supplies, other expenses. So you get a true sense of cost, and then balance that against what kind of financial aid you'll get and scholarships you'll get. And this is one of the problems, is that the federal requirements have a limited set of data that they look at, and it doesn't necessarily give you the full picture of what it's going to cost to go to a particular school. So that's where we get into a little bit of inconsistency with what gets presented. And to me, the biggest challenge is that we want to try to keep the form simple by not asking a lot of questions. But with that simplicity comes inaccuracy. For example, I know a lot of calculators that don't factor in merit aid. They don't factor in scholarships. And for a lot of schools, that's a big piece of the equation. And I almost wonder, these are going to do more harm than good if we're not including a really accurate estimate of the true cost.
Very true, very true. I think that's a really interesting point. So that's the problem, really, is how are these working or how are they not? I'm very curious to see. So if we know the kind of things that they need to include, you know, people have had essentially, well, they had about 2 years to kind of figure that out. So, you know, where do we actually go to start something like this? I mean, where do people go to build these? That's a big question, I think, is how were these built? If a lot of people have gone around and built these, how are they actually going ahead and doing that? I'm sure some are not building them all the same way as others. What are some of the ways that people actually put these together?
Right, so there are three basic ways you can build this tool. One is to use one of the free tools available, either through a place like the College Board or, you know, even the federal government has provided a template you can use. And my guess is the majority of people have taken that route. They have taken what I would consider kind of the easy way out and just used a free tool. You also can build this yourself. You can take, you know, look at the requirements that are made available and build your own tool, or you can use a third-party solution, and there are maybe a dozen companies right now who are providing kind of that third-party approach to this. And again, there's pros and cons to each of those approaches, and again, in what I have looked at, most schools are using, at least the majority are using the free solution. But with that, I don't think they're real accurate, and I'm going to be very curious going forward whether that's going to do more harm than good.
That's a really good point. I mean, there are some, people are out there offering some solutions. I mean, I guess at this point, they're already built. They're already on the site. And that's been making it too. Just so here's a tough question before we even get into a lot of the actual how it's being used. Was there ever any regulation on where it had to be, you know, put on the site? I mean, are these things, it's just the idea just that it has to be used, obviously, and offered. But how much direction were people given with, you know, okay, you're building this. Here's the next step.
Right. There is no requirement in terms of where this gets placed on a website. Some people have made them front and center, but there was just an article, I believe it was in fact, I have it here somewhere. It was in a blog for, hang on one second, because this was interesting. It was in the blog for U.S. News and World Report, actually. Talking about how one of their bloggers went and looked for these and really had a hard time finding them. And I've always been wondering whether people are doing this intentionally or not. Was there a real decision in terms of whether we're going to kind of hide this a little bit, either because we didn't want people to know the results or the results were going to be inaccurate, so they kind of have buried it. I think one of the things that was lacking was, you know, if this tool isn't readily available, is it serving, you know, is it doing any good? And I don't know whether there's going to be any backlash from parents who go and look, or from students who go and look for this tool and can't find it.
Absolutely. And that's why, I mean, I'll pull it up right now. We just had, you know, a great tweet comes in. This is the question really that we're facing, which is, you know, asking, you know, will accuracy of these calculators be detrimental? I mean, what's going to happen if these aren't accurate? What are we looking at here? I think that's a fair question to ask.
Yeah, but I think that's a huge issue. If these are not accurate, they are going to do no good whatsoever. And there's risk on both sides of that. If it overestimates what it's going to cost to go to a particular school, that's going to, you know, turn away people, especially more disadvantaged students from low-income families who may think they can't afford to go to school when in actuality they can. The flip side of that is that if it looks like it's going to be cheaper than it actually is, I wouldn't want to be sitting in the bursar's office or even as a financial aid advisor when somebody had used this tool and then finds out that it cost actually several thousand dollars more to go to school than what they had expected. So I see risk on both sides of that equation.
Absolutely. Now, I think we might have Michael Fienen back. So let me just say, Michael, are you there? You mind piping in for a second?
I think I'm back. Do I sound back?
You are back, and you sound back. Happy to have you back on the program. Happy minutes to make that work. So, Mungo, I don't know how much you were able to follow or miss or not. You know, we've talked about the background a little bit of the calculators, some options for getting them built, the kind of lack of restrictions on where they're going to be placed. And I think that kind of jumps into the meat and potatoes of what we're talking about today, which is looking at these implementations. You know, where do we start to talk about, you know, I don't know, what are your thoughts initially? Again, it's a big question. On what kind of problems you're seeing when looking at how these calculators have been implemented by the market.
Right. So one of the things I've been doing over the past few weeks is kind of keeping an eye on how some schools are implementing calculators. You know, what tools are being used? Are they doing it in-house? Are they using third-party tools? I've probably looked at about 50 calculators here recently, and I would say out of all 50 of them, maybe two or three are doing well-ish. I'm actually really, really disappointed in how we have approached this problem and the solutions that we're finding. And even some of the vendor solutions are sort of foregoing everything we know about good web design. And I think that's what upsets me is this is one of those issues where the federal government stepped in, threw some regulations at us, and we basically turned it into a checklist, right? So we knew what the calculator needed, we handed it off to programmers or to our vendors, and we got a tool that effectively only meets the bare requirements of the legislation. That's nowhere near good enough. And that's what I think I'm finding most upsetting about this right now is we've got a tool, this is the top of your funnel in a lot of ways. This is the tool that can get people talking to a financial aid representative, can get them to apply for a visit, get them to apply to your college. And it's a great way to draw people in, and yet we're throwing away the opportunity. And that's extremely disappointing for them.
Yeah, you know, that's a really interesting point. And that also brings up the point that these calculators don't have any sort of, you know, analytics. This is a stage in the process, in the application process, and all of a sudden these people could be lost. And you know, one thing you brought up is, you know, how much time does it take to go through a calculator? I'll throw that both out to you and Mark from your experiences, either one. You know, what time are you talking about to get the, first off, we already know the numbers aren't necessarily accurate. You don't really know if you're a prospective student, but you land on it, you decide to fill it out. Are you spending 20 seconds? Are you spending 20 minutes? I mean, what are you looking at to get this data? What do you have to give?
Well, I think, do you have, Seth, the analytics screenshot there?
I think so, yeah. Let me get to work. Let me pull that up for you.
I took a look at our analytics and I asked some folks on Twitter about theirs, you know, asking how long do students spend on your site, right? You know, how long are they looking at affordability sites, looking at financial aid sites? And despite the inaccuracies involved with time on site, the answer was still consistently under 2 minutes. And some of the calculators that I've looked at, and when you go through, it's nice to see checklists, it's nice to see this is what you need, this is how much time we're going to take, but several of the calculators will say, we need 10 minutes of your time, we need 15 minutes of your time to fill out these forms. No, that's not what people do. If they see that they're going to have to sit down and commit a measurable amount of time to this tool, of a lot of schools, they don't want people using them, I think. But the way they are set up now, not just the time it takes, but the material it takes to complete them, it does everything it can to discourage people from filling them out.
Now, Mark, is that what your experience is too? I mean, as far as the timing, how much time do you see people spending on these? Do you think people are really completing them? I mean, that's my question. If, as Michael is showing, his site time is so low, I mean, are we seeing abandonment rates? Or do you think people are filling these out and then not actually completing them and just stopping midway through and maybe backing out of the process?
I think it's going to depend on the length of the calculator and whether the value proposition has been stated up front. Again, to get accurate data, you actually have to complete many, many questions and sometimes have some forms with you that you may not have with you. That's a mistake I've seen on a lot of these, is that if you're going to ask somebody to, you know, for example, know the family income and have some, you know, tax documents available, which many of these do, tell them that ahead of time before they get into this form. You know, my recommendation is that you tell somebody up front that this form is going to take, you know, X amount of minutes to complete. Here is the forms you're going to need. Let them know that ahead of time and hopefully provide a value proposition in terms of how long it's going to take. But that being said, we know how impatient people are, and I don't think people are going to spend a lot of time filling these out. And I think that's the challenge with all of these, is that if you make the form simple, it's going to be inaccurate. Mm. But we need to be able to find that sweet spot between keeping it simple and keeping it accurate, really thinking about exactly the questions that need to be asked and do it in as simplistic a manner as possible.
So how do we do that? Yeah, Michael, I'm jumping in. Like, what does that look like? How do we do something like that?
I think one thing we really have to focus on, can you pull up, Seth, the example from, it looks like, Dartmouth.
Yep, it's
number two.
You got
pull up Dartmouth number
all right,
two.
You got it right now. It's a little hard to see, but it is up there, so people are able to look at it.
Okay. You know, one of the problems I think we have is, I mean, there, I say one of the many problems is simply things like questions, right? And when we talk about simplifying them down and making them usable, part of usability comes down to the language we're using. Some of these calculators look like they were written by tax specialists, not by people that you know, think about your users, right? You have 18-year-old kids in some cases filling out or trying to fill out these calculators. You're asking them for W-2s, you're asking them for bank statements, you're asking them about field, you know, what is your net value without your home and all this stuff. And we need to get some of this stuff out. It's not particularly important to the goals. Remember, we're goal-driven people. And when somebody is thinking about how much does it cost to come to your site, their concern is not about what am I going to pay tomorrow. It's about I need just a rough estimate to give me some way to gauge if you're in my ballpark, right? Because they know. It's like you walk on a car lot. You see a sticker price on a car. You know once you talk to the salesman, you're going to get a little bit off that. You're going to find ways to shave some money off, you know, your trade-in. your loan, your interest rate, how much you're paying down, you know, all of these things affect the bottom dollar. And higher ed is no different. People understand that. When we make these things super complicated, when we put all these extra fields in there, we ask for all this information, we create the expectation that we are going to give them a substantially more accurate representation of cost, when we aren't. The end result of some of these calculators is no more accurate after 30 questions than they are after 5 questions. And it's a huge usability problem for them.
Yeah, that's what just kills me too. And I do want to say one thing as we're talking about net price calculators. We're talking about the problems that they pose and how inaccurate a lot of the data is. But, I mean, this is such a tough thing for me personally because I think, you know, the idea of the calculator is a really good idea. The idea of allowing a student to understand what college is actually going to cost is really valuable. And it's something realistically we should have been doing all along. I mean, we're in a position now where, you know, when you talk about fit for a student, you know, it's not just about how are they going to fit in the program. You know, are they going to be able to, you know, have retain them because they're enjoying themselves, they're succeeding, but also is a student going to leave with a manageable amount of debt, and they're going to understand the amount of debt that they have. And these are huge problems. And one thing that bums me about this is that it's not that this is no way you can do it and this is terrible. The fact is that the solution that it's being used is just clearly not functioning right. But it shouldn't be deterring us from trying to find a way to provide information to students. And that's kind of what's frustrating to me, is that I think this idea is something that we should have been doing all along. It's making sure students have an idea of fit in an institution and the cost that they're going to be facing up front, and allowing them realistically to sort of shop around a little bit. But I don't know. I mean, clearly I think the calculator, at least as it's mandated now, is not going to be achieving that in any realistic way.
Yeah, my big issue with this has been, you know, calculators have been around for 15, 20 years. They've always, when done properly, been able to use them as a good enrollment tool. And what I'm concerned is that a lot of colleges are going to look at this as two things, one being an unfunded mandate, and two being just they're going to approach this the same way that I saw web accessibility get approached 10 years ago. There's going to be some federal regulations that come out, and there's a checklist box, and your goal is going to be to comply with, you know, that regulatory issue. When in fact you should be taking a different approach and using this as a way to, you know, the buzzwords that we always use in social media are being transparent and authentic. We need to be transparent and authentic about what it costs to go to a particular school. You know, for me personally, the whole idea of sticker price versus real price for colleges, I find very disgusting. You know, it's almost like we're selling used cars here. Why do we always hide what it, you know, what the true cost is? And at the end of the day, that's what we should be focused on, not trying to meet a regulation, but really being transparent about cost. And in the long run, that's going to serve us well if we do that correctly.
And I think one of the big problems we ran into was the government saw a void, and like government does, it rushed in to fill that void. And with the economic atmosphere the way it is, they said, schools are inflating costs, and, you know, it's students are leaving with so much debt more than they used to, that they said, we need to find a way to make sure students know what it's costing. So here is what you have to do. Go make a calculator. And the reality is, market factors would have driven us to do this and do it right no matter what. Because that's, I think, one of the big advantages here is that if you can learn to do this right and do it in a way that it draws people in, if somebody's looking at your school and 5 other regional schools or divisional schools or whatever the case may be, you have a chance to really stand out if you can get your calculator right and get it to give them the information that they expect to receive and do it in a way that doesn't make them feel like they're getting bent over backwards just to get an estimate from you, because that's all they want. They want a simple way to figure out what's the rough cost. And unfortunately, with the government's regulations on this, it's forced us into, just like what Mark said, we're just trying to meet the base needs. And what makes it worse is that these needs got funneled into our financial aid offices, at some schools, the admissions offices. They didn't originate within marketing and web offices. And at some schools, we may have been cut out. At others, we simply weren't talked to, or we were talked to very late in the process. And the result are these calculators that are developed by programmers and people putting equations together and not thinking about them as a real recruitment tool and the impact it can have on us in that light.
Yeah, I just want to say that that's a really good point. And then, so my question to both of you is, You know, this to me seems like an example of something where the government set the bar incredibly low, in the sense that as far as what's required of you, what's implemented, there's no one policing this. There's really no checks or balances if you're not doing this correctly. So, I mean, I hate to say it, but, you know, is this an example of our industry accepting a dangerously low bar and just saying, okay, if this is the bare minimum that we have to do, then that's what we'll do and move on? That's a dangerous thought to me, and that is really an unfortunate one if we as an industry are saying, okay, this is all you're requiring of us, even if we know that's not going to accomplish anything, not deliver a positive experience for our students, not make our students make a smart decision and increase fit, you know, yet we've still accepted that just because that's all you've asked of us.
Right, and I share that thought. You know, my concern with this is that people are going to look at this as the solution to the problem about being authentic about price. And I just don't think that's a realistic approach, because a lot of these tools do not do a good job of that. And I think they're going to not focus on this as a problem anymore. You know, one of my big things right now is that we, you know, as you look at the cost of colleges escalating and skyrocketing so quickly, we have got to really be true to how much it costs to go to a particular school and be able to articulate that value. You know, as I've looked at this, most colleges, this has come out of the financial aid office and usually has been driven through the financial aid office. And there hasn't been a connection to how people, you know, in the admissions office and enrollment function can use this positively and proactively. You know, I would love to see on these calculators, you know, places to start a conversation. So instead of just leaving somebody, go and fill the calculator out, get your result, and that's the end of it, use this as a way to start a conversation with the financial aid folks about all of the things in place on a campus to help you afford to school. And, you know, this is also a way even to get secret shoppers into your marketing funnel. You know, most people right now who are filling this out have not identified themselves. If you can show them, here is, you know, this is the starting point, let us help you understand costs and let us help you understand the value on our campus, I think you're going to be, you know, way ahead in the game.
Totally. I can't stress that enough. I totally agree with you that there's a real opportunity here for marketing. And one thing that I would say is, you know, within this calculators on that same page, a lot of schools I'm seeing are using the live chat feature where you can chat live with an admissions rep. There's no reason you don't have that button there. That someone, if someone's there and someone's filling out your calculator, you better believe they're a serious potential lead. So why are you not engaging them? And why are you telling them, unless you finish this entire process, we can't talk to you? If you're on that page is important. If you're filling that information out, you're making a commitment of time that you really want to know this stuff. So find a way to connect with those people. And even if the calculator's not doing a great job, get them on your radar, talk to them, communicate with them. I think that's a big missed opportunity. I do want to pull back real quick. There's a question that came back in from Patrick Powers. I'll throw out to either one of you, which is basically said, what if you don't even meet the bare minimum? I mean, let's say an institution just never even did a calculator. What kind of punishments are they looking at from the government for just not doing this at all or doing it way below what's required?
I've read the spec over and over, and I've had the conversation with folks. And as far as I can tell, there is no penalty involved. There is no enforcement mechanism on this, which is both good and bad, depending on how you look at it. If anybody has read something else in the Higher Ed Opportunity Act that I am not familiar with, feel free to share it on Twitter. But that section, which I think is 130, it's either 122 or 132, I forget now. I think, Seth, you've got the link to that document you can share out. It talks all about what you need to have, and there are other components of the Higher Ed Opportunity Act that include enforcement mechanisms and fines and penalties and all this. But as far as the calculator goes, there really isn't anything, which, like I say, is a double-edged sword in a lot of ways. And I think one trap we fell into with this, and going back to the idea of having like live chat features and all this other stuff, we've missed out on all these opportunities to build on it because it now became something with a finish line. You know, the finish line is having it calculate EFC and bring in all, you know, the tuition costs and housing and miscellaneous costs minus your scholarships and financial aid, and okay, finish line, we're done. When the reality is these kinds of tools don't have a finish line. You know, next year we have to update the numbers. That's another opportunity to maybe make it easier to use, perhaps. You know, think about, could you tie it into data that you've already collected from the student? If you have an admissions portal, you may be able to vacuum some of that stuff in. We can't look at these kinds of tools as items that have finish lines, because then they get put on a shelf until they rot away. And that becomes a bad part of your site and becomes something you have to completely redesign, which isn't efficient in any aspect. So I diverged a little bit, but the penalty is sort of, I think, internal at this point if you aren't doing it, because the one thing that they did at least get people doing is focusing on it, and if you don't have one, even if it's a bad one, you will be behind your competitors.
Now that brings up a question. Let me ask this to both of you then. How many students, and this is probably just more of a hypothetical at this point, it's still too early to really tell or track something like this, how many students of ours or of anyone's are shopping around and using calculators on multiple sites? And the reason I ask this is, you know, does that mean then if you're doing your calculator right and you're doing it at the best you can and trying to deliver the best experience and the best numbers, could a competitor just be essentially shorting a few things here and there and kind of inflating their numbers to compete? I mean, how could an institution even defend against that if that's something that students are using to shop, you know, multiple institutions against each other?
Yep, sure. I think a couple pieces of that. One is that there is risk, I think, when people are using this as a comparison tool. Because the specs are so vague, you're comparing apples to oranges. So I would, you know, counsel students not to really use it that way because it really can be inaccurate. The second piece is that the e-expectation survey last year, when they did this in February, you know, that's when the data got collected for 2011, there were questions in there about cost calculators. And there's some good data. I'll share that link out to people for the 2011 e-expectations report. Looking at this, I'm going to share this real quickly. This is for students. 36% of students had used a cost calculator. We asked, you know, how did it influence your perception of the school? 21% said it was positive. 22% said it was both positive and negative. 8% said it was mostly negative. And 50% said there was no influence. Now, this was before a lot of schools had it, so I'm excited that in both a kind of a midterm e-expectations report that'll be done this wintertime, and then in the full e-expectations report for 2012, this question will be out there as well.
That's great. I'm really excited to see that data, because I think that ultimately is something that's going to really factor in how we actually improve these and move forward, is understanding how students use them or don't. So it's really interesting. So questioning coming in from Patrick Powers. Michael, weigh in first, and then I'll pull that question in.
I was just going to throw out there real fast. Another problem with the comparison argument is something that we faced here at Pitt State, which was our in-state versus out-of-state. In our case, it's not as clear cut-and-dry decision as, oh, you're in-state, oh, you're out-of-state. We actually, because we are an institution on a state border, we offer in-state tuition rates to students within two counties of the school, into Missouri, Arkansas, and Oklahoma. So even though they're out-of-state students and would identify themselves as out-of-state, we had sort of a hurdle to overcome to try to figure out how do we get them to understand that you get in-state tuition. You get to come here much cheaper than anybody else, kind of back to the accuracy argument. We also offer half full-time or half out-of-state tuition in certain programs across the country, depending on what state you're from, based on very complex, and I don't really understand all the arrangements we have, but it makes it very, very difficult. So when students are using them as comparison tools, I think that's why you have to balance that idea of, let's just give them the bare minimum, let's give them a starting place, but help them understand that if you talk to us, if you call us, if you chat with us, we can get you the information you want, and then on the back side of that, yay, we have them in our funnel now kind of deal.
Totally. What's a really good point, too, about how students are using it? I think your example of being right near on a state border is a really interesting one. That's one that I hadn't thought of before. So this question, though, brings up both to you, Mark. Back to one more point that you said, and it ties into what Patrick Powers sent in a question saying, how high are the expectations among prospectives that what the calculators show is accurate? And this brings up the broader question I'm curious is, Do prospective students even know about this? And I know that we'll be relying a lot more on like the No-Levitz data, for instance, next year, telling us what students are experiencing and thinking. But the way I've seen this presented on a lot of the websites, and I did a bunch of searching the last couple weeks looking through this, not a lot of them explain exactly what a net price calculator is. And I'll be honest, the term itself doesn't really tell you. And I found that I'm just curious, what are students expecting they're getting? Even if they're seeing a number, do they really even understand what that number necessarily means?
That's a great question. Anecdotally, as I've talked with students both on our campus and prospective students in my travels, I don't think they do understand what this is telling them. And I also think, when I look at a lot of the calculators, there are so many disclaimers saying that this is only an estimate, it's not going to be real accurate, you're going to have to talk to a financial aid advisor, et cetera, I'm not sure when you see that many disclaimers why anybody would ever fill this out in the first place. So I think we need to do a better job of educating the public. And that's something just in general I think that higher ed needs to do a better job of, is educating the public on what goes into determining a cost, you know, on every campus, and then, you know, giving them the tools to understand how the process works. You know, unfortunately, at the end of the day, the financial aid process is very, very complex. I was at the AMA conference last week in Chicago, and great speaker Nancy Burke talking about a parent's kind of view of the whole college admissions process, and she came up with the following acronym for FAFSA, and her acronym was Futile Attempt for Securing Assistance. So that's the way that, you know, parents kind of look at this, is it just, this is such a nightmare. It's a process we have to go through. We don't understand it. We wish there was a simpler way. And I would love us to be able to come up with a way. And again, as Michael said, not using all of the jargon, whether it's tax jargon, whether it's FAFSA jargon, explain in ways that people can understand what determines the cost of going to every particular college.
Absolutely.
Hey, Seth, if you would, pull up either Indiana Bloomberg or Dartmouth's, Dartmouth One.
We got Dartmouth up right now.
Okay. You know, one of the problems, we were thinking about the calculator issue, and we actually didn't call it a calculator on our site. We've called it, what will your first year cost? And put a link on the financial aid page and the affordability pages, because that's the question people would ask when they come to that page. I think I've seen some numbers roll through on some folks. I know, Mark, your guys' numbers are really low, and I think it was Patrick or somebody said they had like 400 views. We've had over 1,000 views in the past month. Pretty good, despite our fact that we kind of discourage people from using it. But like in Dartmouth's case, talking about jargon and understanding what the net price calculator is, people like Dartmouth, people like Indiana Bloomberg using, I think they're using College Boards. Dartmouth, I think, is self-written, if I remember right. You get hit with this wall of text, the first thing. And, you know, one of the first things we learn in web writing and everything is that people scan, people run through real quickly. And the worst part is, like with Dartmouth, you have to choose which calculator you need here based on how much money you have, unless, of course, your parents are separated, in which case you have to go to another page and read a whole nother wall of text, only to find out you need to go back to the same calculator regardless. That's not the right way to do that. And I know we have to have the disclaimers. This is part of the government getting in the way. I would be happy to put a disclaimer on all without them telling me to. But we put up huge pages of disclaimers, huge pages of explanation that nobody reads. Indiana Bloomberg's is interesting, and not just them, but anybody using the College Board, because they use basically the same splash page, that by the time you've got to the bottom of the page and you've scrolled all the way down, all the actionable stuff ends up way above the fold. And so by the time you reach the bottom of the page, there's no indication that there's still something you can do there. And so you've put one more barrier in the way. Hey, I thought I was getting a net price calculator. I clicked the link. It said net price calculator. And you sent me to a page that's got freaking 1,500 words on it. That's not what I was expecting. That's a problem that we need to work around and start thinking about, you know, not just the wording we're using in links, but then the wording we're using on the pages and helping them understand what this is, why it's there, and why it can really be helpful for them.
Yeah, I totally agree. I just want to say one thing. I said this a little bit earlier, but yeah, I'll throw this out to both of you guys. You know, when we talk about net price calculators, then, I mean, obviously we said that it's not the problem that's the problem. It was the very poorly forced upon implemented solution. I mean, this is a huge problem. This is a piece of something much bigger. I mean, people understanding the cost of college and understanding this. You know, where do you guys see this moving, whether it's beyond calculators or not? I mean, it seems like my fear is that this is posing such a problem due to its poor implementation, which can be often expected with bureaucratic legislation, that people are going to decide this is not a problem they need to solve, as opposed to understanding that this was a poor solution to a problem they absolutely must address. You know, is this, how do we do this? And I bring this up because this is something that I think we agree is, I'm not seeing this conversation happening. They talked about it 2 years ago and people had to do it. There's a little bit of coverage, but you know, the media is not talking about it. There's no buzz on Twitter. This is not a sexy conversation we're having right now, guys. We're talking about net price calculators, but I would argue it's one of the more important conversations I've ever addressed on this show. And yet I fear that it's going to fall on deaf ears because it's not sexy, it's not glossy, it's not shiny and cool and different, or because people are just so distraught or upset about the currently poorly executed solution. How do we shift that? How do we get a dialogue going around this? Because I don't know. I feel like we need to. I feel like the fact this isn't being talked about only means that we're going to perpetuate a problem even more, make it worse, and continue to fail to provide students an opportunity to actually accurately understand what college is going to cost.
I agree with that completely. That, you know, my concern is that people are going to look at this problem, the net cost or net price calculator, solve this problem of true cost, when in fact I think it's going to ultimately do more harm than good. You know, I'll go back to what Michael said earlier. Eventually, market forces are going to come into play here, and if you are being, you know, if you're not being transparent about costs, the market's going to catch up with you. And everything I've been talking about over the last 5 years about higher ed being flattened, that's all becoming true. And if you're not paying attention to these kinds of issues, you're going to be flattened. You're going to be left behind. People are not going to, you know, you're going to lose a lot of trust in the marketplace if you're not being completely straightforward about cost. Again, I mentioned before that there have been a lot of work done with cost calculators and scholarship calculators going back 10 or 15 years. The reason you should be doing this is not because there is a federal mandate. The reason you should be doing this is because you want to be totally transparent and as accurate as possible about what it costs to go to your school.
And one thing I would say is now that these are out there, now that we're done-ish with the process and we've met our requirements or whatever the case may be, because this started, I think, in the wrong place, because this started as a financial aid problem as opposed to a web problem, your marketing offices need to step in now. The marketing offices need to inject their take on this, or the admissions office, whoever, however your school is structured, and start and point out the fact that this is an enrollment and an engagement opportunity that we need to take hold of. Let's take it to the next level. Your web offices should step in and say, okay, you have this tool, but it's awful. I can show you it's awful because I have analytics that supports that. I can show you where people are bailing out of the funnel. You know, we've got 1,000 people starting it, but 100 people finishing it. That's a major problem. Of course, that depends on what kind of analytics you can run on your, if your platform is third party, that can be a problem. But like folks who are using Noel Levitz, for instance, I know they provide analytics on their calculator, letting you know if people are finishing it and whatnot. Figure that out. I think long-term, as we start thinking about how to make this good, because there is a way to do this right. I talk about it a little bit in the .edu guru article I did just before the deadline came up, that I think what we need to look at is more of almost a two-tiered approach, so that when you go to the financial aid page and you go to the calculator or whatever you want to call it, the first thing you see is a calculator that has no more than 4 or 5 fields. One page gives you the answer right there, doesn't ask you anything that you don't know up here. You know, no W-2s, no tax returns, no bank statements, none of that crap. Because students, 18-year-old kids don't have that sitting at their desk when they have the question. And they're not going to get up and go get it. I guarantee you that. Start with a simple calculator and give them the bare minimum number. Just get them a number. And at the bottom of that, then offer the full federal calculator and say, would you like more information? Would you like to improve the accuracy of this? If you'll give us 10 minutes of your time now, we can tell you more. If you don't want to do that right now, that's okay. We understand. Here's a base number, but just understand this is sticker price and it's not going to be real accurate for you. When you keep the form simple, they'll understand that it's a very rough estimate. At least that's certainly my hope.
Mark, do you want to weigh in on all that? Was an interesting solution, you know, from Fienen that he's suggesting here. You know, what are your thoughts on how we can correct this and actually move forward? Because I didn't think Michael's points were well taken on how to make something like this actually work.
Yeah, but I've actually seen that deployed at a few schools where they have a very simple calculator to let you know, and they're very upfront that this is a very rough estimate. And before you go into the details about getting a more, you know, a more accurate estimate, it kind of just puts things in the proper process where it doesn't waste a lot of time and energy if you can know right up front whether this school is something you can afford or not. And I think it's in both a college's best interest and in a student's best interest to be able to accurately identify very early in the process whether a student can afford to go to this school or not. Because if that person can't afford to go there, and that's an accurate statement, the sooner they know that and the sooner you know that, the better off both of you are, because that's just not a good fit financially. And again, that's a hard pill for a lot of, you know, expensive private schools to swallow. But at the end of the day, if somebody can't afford to go there, they can't afford to go there.
Absolutely. I can't agree with that enough. I mean, that's why that kind of conversation is all about the long game. It's not about the short game. It's not about your numbers this quarter. It's about getting the right students in. It's about fit, which increases retention, which increases student success, provides the right students with the right experience. It just changes lives. And that's what's important. And that's kind of a fundamental thing. And if you go back and you read your charter or your mission, whether you're private, you're nonprofit, go back and read your mission. I say that all the time. I actually do that. I do it all the time. Understand why you're there. When you do, you start to realize that those are the kind of things you need to think about, finding the right students. And these kind of tools can be used to do that, because unfortunately, if they're used wrong, it can do the exact opposite. It can give students wrong information, and they're going to have a big wake-up call when that numbers come in, and they're not going to be happy about it. And they're either going to leave or they're going to finish and leave very unhappy. And that's not a win for anyone. And that's why, I mean, the long game here is utilizing this stuff to get the right people in the door and to engage the right students. And yet, unfortunately, I think sometimes that conversation is lost a little bit. I mean, all the media coverage I ever read about this issue ever was always just about, oh, you're required to do a calculator. Here's what you should know, need to know. Here's some regulation. And there was never a real conversation about what are we really doing here. And I think that's a very, very valid point.
I love Mike Petroff's comment here. He just threw through Twitter. He's saying, why don't you just post total tuition and room board costs up front on your financial aid pages? Doesn't that show the sticker price? And it does, and I think that that is 100% the right thing to do. The problem is are allergic to the idea of treating their school like a product. And I think that's something we need to kind of just get a handle on with the calculators and understand that people care about cost. And whether you view your degrees as products or services or whatever you have to do to justify it to yourself, people want to know the number. And if you give them the number, if you answer their questions, the odds of you converting them are, you know, increased immeasurably. So I think, yeah, I do think we should be sticking those prices. If I had my way, every program page on our site would include a cost button. That would show it to you just like if you were on Amazon and say, here's the high number, here's the low number, basically. Click to get more information, because once you've clicked it, now you're in my funnel, now we can start hounding you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely agree. Yeah, please, Mark, weigh in.
Yep. For me, in a perfect world, we would have accurate net price calculators available. And for me, this would force schools to really look at what people are going to be paying and making sure they can justify that cost and justify that value. You know, I think there is still a lot of inefficiencies within higher education, and a lot of this doesn't get rooted out. But if there was a clear picture about what it costs to go to school, maybe some of those inefficiencies would go away and we could provide more value.
Absolutely agree. And I hope to see this stuff. I mean, I hope this is a conversation that moves forward. So one last question to both of you guys before I let you guys, you know, say anything else you want to, as we move forward, is whose issue is this? And I say this because if someone's watching and they're in marketing, is this a marketing issue or is it only web? Or if someone's in financial aid, is it their issue? Where does the ownership fall, and if at all, in within our own institutional boundaries, our own silos, where does this issue really fall for either of you?
For me, this is an enrollment management issue. It is not a financial aid issue, even though there's a connection there. You know, this is a very, you know, when you look at the kinds of things that students consider about where they're going to go to school, I always go back to the five things that Noel Levitz has talked about in terms of what a student looks for. They want to know if you have the academic major. They want to know if they can get in, if they have the grades to get in. They want to know the application process. They want to know, will the economy today, probably the number one thing they want to know, can they afford it? And this is an enrollment issue, and this, quite frankly, is a senior leadership issue as well, because if you're not getting students in the door, I'm not sure you're going to have a door 5 years from now. So this is something that's got to go well beyond the financial aid office and really be looked at as an enrollment management issue, and hopefully something even senior leadership is thinking about.
And I would say this drives to the very heart of customer service problems. You know, and regardless of who on your campus is responsible for the customer service, quote unquote, aspect of your university, that's who should be paying attention to this. And if that's marketing, then it's marketing. If it's admissions, then it's admissions. It's going to be different depending on how your school is structured. But it is something that is very high, you know, top level leadership type deal needs to step in on this, because it is a major, major component of the decision making process. And that's why I tend to feel like marketing is probably just specifically one of the better aspects to come at this, because they can kind of handle the massaging of how you get this information out and present it, at least theoretically, in a way that the students can digest and will encourage them to continue down the funnel path, thinking in terms of, you know, admissions, enrollment management, that these are all in their own way functions of marketing. And so I think that's part of where that problem starts, and part of where it can stop in the long run.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, I guess I appreciate, you know, those thoughts. I really agree with both of you. And I think importantly, the other answer is, you know, wherever you lie down and where you work, wherever your situation is, that's where this lies too. I mean, this is something that we all need to deal with and think about. So, you know, don't feel like if it doesn't fit perfectly that you can't ask about it, that you can't check it out. And I do think, like most things in higher ed, you know, proper cross-collaboration is the answer, and that's unfortunately something that doesn't happen a lot. So guys, you know, as we've talked about net price calculators, we've talked about the problems, talked about some of the possible solutions, I mean, what are your final thoughts to both of you as we kind of slowly wrap this discussion up? What's next? What should you be doing? What are tangible next steps? Or just what are some final wisdoms you would like to impart?
I would say, don't be afraid to think outside the box on this, because everybody has got entirely too caught up on how to make an HOEA compliant calculator, and that is the absolute wrong way to approach this problem. Instead, sit down and figure out, what do my students need? What do my prospectives need to get them to start this decision-making process? And how do I need to present that information to them in a way that makes sense to them and is right for them? And if that means you have to make a calculator that does not meet federal standards, then by God, that's what you do. And you have your federal calculator, and you put it in there, and you bury it wherever you have to bury it so you can at least say you have it. But frankly, I would rather answer for doing the right thing than skate by doing what is ultimately the wrong thing. And the way that some of the comments here, Mike again saying, you know, net price calculators are not the elegant solution, is so true, because the government has screwed it up, and that's all that this is going to perpetuate. So if all you worry about are those specs and those standards, you will never get this right. Instead, get user-centric, put your feet on the ground, and talk to the people who are applying to your school. Talk to your students, talk to high schoolers, figure out what their needs are, because if you don't do that, you will never get this right.
Let me just add two things. One is, I hope as we go forward, we will focus more on some of the usability and accessibility aspects of these tools. My experience has been that most of them leave a lot to be desired. I'll leave it at that. And that just follow best practices when it comes to form design in terms of usability and accessibility. And the second thing is really just looking at this at the big picture and trying to be, you know, truly transparent about what it costs to go to a school and having the mindset that this is beneficial for your students and beneficial for you as well.
Absolutely. I could not agree more with that. And with that, I just want to say both to you, again, thank you so much. So thank you guys to our guests, Mark Greenfield, Director, Office of Web Services, University of Buffalo, speaker and associate consultant with No Limits. And thank you as well to Michael Fienen, Director of Web Marketing for Pitt State, CTO for NewCloud, and a writer at Edu Guru. So both of you guys, thank you so much for coming on and having this conversation.
Thanks for having us.
Yep. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, listen, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. I want to hear what you are doing, so let's keep this conversation going. If you think you have a calculator that's done right, let me know. We will feature it on HigherEdLive if we really think it's the best. So please let us know about that. And thank you guys for watching today's show and bearing with us. I know we had a little bit of hiccups here and there at tech. We're trying out Google Plus on the back end to bring you multiple guests, more thought leaders, more information, packing it into the same little time frame that we try to each week. That's what we're trying to do. Let me know what you thought. As always, I want your feedback. And finally, I am off next week. It's Thanksgiving, I know. I'm actually going to take a day off. So we'll be back in 2 weeks. We'll be launching some new shows, some new information. You can find out all about that at higheredlive.com. So once again, thank you for tuning in. Thank you to our guests. And thank you for caring about a subject matter that isn't terribly sexy. It isn't awesome. It isn't cool. It's not Facebook. It's not a buzzword. But by God, it matters. And I really appreciate that you understand that. And I appreciate that you're going to make this an issue that you care about and talk about at your institution, because someone has to, and I'm really, really appreciative that there's people in the industry like you that are investing this time to do it. So with that, I am Seth Odell. This is Higher Ed Live, the live weekly web show about the world of higher education. I will see you all in 2 weeks, taking one off, and just a final thank you as well to our sponsors who always help make this show possible, and that is none other than Integral, OmniUpdate, and Scavenger. I'll see you all real soon.